Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. I'm back, and it's been an absolute long time. I think it's been a good 6 weeks, but apologies in advance. I've been sorting out my mental health. I found out that for 7 or 8 years, I've actually been suffering in silence with bipolar type 2 hypomania. But don't worry, I'm still the same old crazy me. And apart from now, I'm medicated on something called quetiapine, or as the Americans like to call it, Seroquel. Luckily enough, I can still have a couple of beers here and there. So that's good for me and many others that enjoy my company. Big shout to tonight's sponsor, which is car-ching.co.uk. They are the largest car buying company in the northeast of England, and they will buy anything from a low-cost banger all the way up to, I don't know, let's say a Bugatti Veyron. But speaking of beers, I've got a guest tonight. Now, this is a man, a very happy chap that I've been following, I would say, probably for about 6 or 7 months on YouTube now. He's a very smiley fella, and he's full of good crack, and he always cheers me up. I just randomly stumbled across him, to tell you the truth, because I started maturing a little bit from the mass-produced lagers and wanted to endeavour into the beer world. And I just typed in a beer title one day, and the first face that popped up was my friend, and I would dare say probably the greatest beer reviewer on planet Earth, because not only is he English, he also tells you exactly how it is from the smell to the taste. It is Paul from Paul's Beers. Good evening.
Good evening, mate. Thank you for that rather flattering introduction.
Well, as I told you on your live, Paul, I don't lick bottoms, I just tell the truth. And to be perfectly honest with you, mate, I just stumbled across you randomly. I think I typed in something on YouTube, something daft like IPA review or something stupid. And you were the first person to actually pop up.
Yeah, that's the way that it kind of happens. You keep putting out videos, eventually my ugly mug's going to turn up somewhere. So, that seems to be the way it goes.
It's when you tend to type in a beer name and then review, it's usually you or three Americans called KY. They tend to pop up. You're very, believe it or not, your face is very popular on YouTube when it comes to the beers.
I wasn't aware of that. There's a lot of other channels out there that I would say are bigger than mine. So to see me getting a bit of coverage, that's good to hear. I guess that's encouraging.
Now, I'll be brutally honest with you. The only reason why I originally enjoyed your videos was because you had that swag, swagger, Cockney accent, and I thought, well, this guy's not pulling any punches. He's telling you how it smells. He's telling you if it's skunked. He's giving you the true flavour, and he's telling you if he recommends it or not. So I just
I think that's the way to go. If you're gonna review a product, you've got to be honest, because if you start talking nonsense, I think people can see through that pretty quickly. I'll tell it as it is. If a beer's not very good, then I can't recommend it. If a beer's blinding, then yeah, by all means, I will tell people they should probably go out and buy it. But at the end of the day, it's all subject. It's all down to your own taste. But I'll tell it as I see it.
And that's what I enjoy the most about your videos, Paul, because I'm not going to mention who it was. I probably, to be fair, I can't even remember who it was, but I like to check out the other reviews as well, the other beer reviews, and there was this one guy, he was an American, and I swear to God, Paul, it took him about 8.5 minutes of the video before he even put his lips around the glass.
Yeah, I think reviewers all have their different styles. You get some that it's done in about 3 or 4 minutes, you get others that have a great big introduction and a chat about the brewery, and say some of them take about 20 minutes to get the beer down their throat. So I think we've all got our different style. I think mine is mine is generally to the point. I don't want to bore people to death. You know, at the end of the day, we've got beer to drink, and that takes time. So I'm not going to waste anyone's talking absolute nonsense. You know what I mean?
So I just thought I'd quickly put this out there as well tonight, because I'm talking to you. And the conversations that are going to go backwards and forwards, I have decided to put on my Newcastle United shirt that has McEwen's lager printed across it.
Oh, blimey. The good old days.
So there's a blast from the past for you.
Just a bit, yeah. I remember watching that the Newcastle teams back in the day with great fondness.
Wow. So on my podcast, I usually start from the beginning. So I would like to know. Obviously, we can tell by your accent that you're from London, but I'd like to know where you grew up, what your childhood was like, and just basically that.
Oh, right. Well, I actually grew up in a county called Hertfordshire, which is it's literally just north of London. And I kind of lived on the border of it. I lived in a place called St Albans growing up there, and it's you literally can't get much closer to it. We've got Barnet, which is like the most northern borough of London, which is about 10 minutes away. Both my parents are Londoners, born and raised in London, and then they kind of moved out of London when they kind of got married. They felt that having kids in London wasn't a particularly good idea at the time. Things were getting a little bit bad in that area, so they decided they could move out. They had that luxury. I was lucky. I grew up in a little village in St Albans, and my childhood was great. I had lots of open space and lots of fields and things to run around and cause as much trouble and mayhem as I possibly could. Good marriage between my mum and dad. I had an older sister, younger brother, who I still talk to on the regular basis. I had a good upbringing. So I've got no complaints there.
And it sounds nice and quite a surprise that you had fields and that to bomb about on, because to a northeast. Like a Geordie, we just see London as big tall buildings and lots of cars.
Exactly. So a lot of me mates still live in town. They still live in London. I'm in and out of town quite often, sort of all sorts of reasons. But ultimately, I grew up in a village just outside London. So I was quite lucky, really. I had plenty of open space. I didn't live in a high rise or nothing like that. So I was one of the lucky ones, really.
Now I'm not actually a Geordie, I'm a Northumbrian, or what we would call it up here, a pit yagger. And my wife is an actual full on Geordie. Now we say the only way you're a full on Geordie is if you are born and raised around the banks of the Tyne. So the Cockney thing, is it true that you're only a real Cockney if you were born around the Bells of Bow?
The real Cockneys tend to come from sort of East London. Yeah. More of an East London thing. That's kind of my understanding of it. So my parents weren't proper Cockneys. They didn't come out with a Cockney rhyming slang or anything like that. You know, they just had that subtle kind of London twang that I've kind of got to my accent. But you won't hear me coming out with the apples and pears and all that nonsense. You know, it's very much a baited concept, and I think the only people who still really talk like that tend to be sort of East End of London, that kind of area.
Yeah, like your Danny Dyer and stuff.
Yeah.
So there is actually a difference then between a Londoner and a Cockney, guys. So if you're like Bethnal Green, Bow Bells, that kind of part, that you're a Cockney, but if you're from anywhere else, you're just classed as a Londoner.
Just a Londoner, yeah. Pretty much. The days of the Cockney are... Unfortunately, they've kind of gone. You still get some older generations that you can be a proper Cockney, but the way of the Cockney is dying out, unfortunately.
But believe it or not, the Cockney rhyme and slang is actually slowly slipping up north now. You know, did you know that?
I didn't know, for example,
it could just fall in normal Geordie conversation. Like you could say, oh, yeah, mate, where you going? I'm just going up the street. All right, well, can you jump up the apples and pears first and make sure your boat race is clean? You know, stuff like that.
Yeah,
so,
there's a lot of them are quite catchy, aren't they, to be fair.
I mean, my father's from Kent, so that they call that, like, the posh Cockney, isn't it?
Yeah, I think people from sort of Kent and Essex and areas like that, they you can normally sort of spot the difference between the two.
The difference I noticed was the people from Kent have a little bit of a slower twang. So like a Londoner will go, "What, mate?" And the guy from Kent will be like, "You're right." Yeah, it's an extended in the world.
I think mine comes out when I've had a couple of beers. I think mine comes out a little bit more when I relax. I become more of a. I think the London twang comes in a little bit more. But when I haven't had a few and I'm just kind of a normal, I kind of sound like this. But once I get a couple of pints down me, then you got to really listen hard, otherwise you lose me.
So obviously you had a sweet childhood. It was all grand. Teenage years. What kind of teenager were you? Were you like a punk, a skin, a chav, a normal guy, a rocker?
I was definitely more into me rock music. There was a lot of music around me when I was growing up. My parents were both well into their music, as was my sister. My sister was really into her music. She did performing arts and she was a singer and all that.
Wow.
So I always had the music around me. So I kind of knew from particularly my teenage years, I listened to a lot of music that was a lot different from a lot of me mates. You know, I think a lot of me mates, their music was inspired by what was kind of popular. Whereas me, I was more inspired by the music that my parents would listen to and things like that. So music was always a big influence, and football was always a massive influence on me. Obviously, where we were from, I had a lot of family in Tottenham. I knew of Tottenham before I even knew they had a football club. Do you know what I mean? So there was only ever going to be one football club in my life, and that was the case from a very young age. So when I was a teenager, as long as I had a football near me and some music in my ears, I was quite happy. You know?
Good man. You see, and that's the thing about London as well. You see, because up here in the northeast, you've only got realistically. Three teams. If you're on the Tyne, you're Newcastle United. If you're on the Weir, you're Sunderland. And if you're on the Tees, you're Middlesbrough. So how do you actually decide what football team you follow in London? Because there's so bloody many. There's at least five, I think.
That's it. I think they choose you, really. If anything, if I could go back to my childhood and choose me team again, I'd probably just choose not to support any particular team and just enjoy the game, because all my clubs have ever done is stress me out. So I didn't really have a choice. Like I say, my family was very Tottenham orientated. It was very Tottenham Hotspur orientated, and that was that. And I didn't have a problem with it. You know, I bought into it. You know, one of my earliest memories of Tottenham Hotspur was your local boy Paul Gascoigne. Watching him, you know, absolutely humiliate defenders in the white Tottenham shirt was just something I still see to this day. Still something I can remember watching as a little lad, and it was magic. That was magic then, and that kind of helped build up my love for football.
Now, I actually watched a podcast the other day with Paul Gascoigne, because he's one of my football heroes, obviously, along with Shearer and the Milburns, because my hometown where I was born and brought up, Jackie Milburn and the Charltons came from there. In Ashington. Yeah. But when I was watching the podcast with Gazza, he actually told the truth why he went to Tottenham. Did you know why he went to Tottenham?
Well, he offered him more money, wasn't
it? Nah, it wasn't. It was because they said they would buy his mum and dad a house and his sister a sunbed.
That's right. He was supposed to be joining Man United.
And on the way to Manchester, he got a phone call off Tottenham saying, "Oh, we'll buy your mum and dad a house and we'll get your sister a sunbed." And he was like, "Okay, I'm going to Tottenham."
So, that was it.
He's off his bloody nut.
He was a character, and he's Paul. He knew what he wanted.
Who would you say was the greatest player to ever wear the white with the bird on it?
Oh, blimey! I'm 37, so I've never really seen Spurs win bugger all, apart from a few League Cups here and there. But I mean, I think Gazza was my first footballing hero. Since then, we've had sort of David Ginola, the Frenchman, again another one who plays for Newcastle.
Yeah.
Absolutely worshipped the ground that he walked on. He was a fantastic footballer. We had Ledley King in defence, brilliant defender. But to be honest, I think the best player I've ever seen play in a Spurs shirt plays for us at the moment is Harry Kane. I think the boy is an incredible footballer. If anything, he's underrated.
I actually adore Harry Kane. He's great for England as well. I don't adore him when we're against him. but I would agree with that, Harry Kane as well. And there's something about the French football players, because at the moment, our best player is probably Alan Saint-Maximin.
He's a talented boy, isn't he, that lad?
That man has got some moves.
Yeah, he does. I love it. I love to watch a player who can just humiliate defenders. A player that makes you want to watch, you know.
I just wish we scored some goals last night, that's all.
You were up against an informed Chelsea side, weren't you? That's the only thing.
The new manager has never had a loss yet. There's been five or six games, and it's been 1-0, 2-0, 1-0, 2-0.
Yeah, they beat us the other day with a penalty. Tight game, but they were the better side. But they done us the other day, which wasn't very nice, but they're doing all right at the moment.
And then you got tortured off Man City.
Yes, that was always going to happen. They're flying at the moment, but they should be, really, with the amount of money that's been pumped into that team. So.
But it's like I said to you the other night on your live, Paul, on Saturday, it could be worse. You could be 17th with Steve Bruce as your manager.
I wouldn't wish that on anyone. It's tricky, that, isn't it? I mean, what would you get rid of first at Newcastle, the owner or the manager?
I'd get rid of Mike Ashley instantly.
Yeah.
Mike Ashley, let someone else come in, because we've had some interest from some Arabs, and you know fine and full well when the Arabs get involved, it's a different ball game. Pardon the pun.
Yeah, normally they really put the money in behind it, don't they? It fell through, didn't it, that deal?
There's some rumours going around that it's back on, or there's some sort of other deal, but you never know what to believe in football, you know?
Nah, the story changes day to day, doesn't it?
Ashley's supposed to have been selling the tune for the last 3 years.
Yeah, so I think it's from a Newcastle perspective, that must be bloody awful when you want him out and you think it's going to happen.
And he's not even a Newcastle United fan, believe it or not, he's a Tottenham Hotspur fan.
Yeah, he's a Spurs fan, he's Mike Ashley, he's from his neck of the woods, so it's an odd one, I mean, it's literally a business thing, and I never like it when you get these businessmen involved in football, and they couldn't give a monkeys about the club that they're investing in. I always think that's, you're on a hiding to nothing when that happens. It's a bit worrying, but it seems to be happening all around the world, doesn't it, you know?
Well, it's all right, because as long as Mike Ashley's at Newcastle United, I'm boycotting Sports Direct.
they're a bloody jumble sale anyway, aren't they, Sports Direct?
Well, most of the clothes are on the floor than the railings.
Yeah, it's disgusting. I don't like Sports Direct shops. You go in there, you want one thing, you can't bloody find it, because there's stuff all over the place.
Exactly. And I've seen things go in there that haven't come out yet.
They've lost them. Once they go in there, no one finds them ever again.
It's like, have you seen John? No, he went missing 4.5 weeks ago. Oh, he's stuck in the jumble sale at Sports Direct.
No, he's gone in amongst the trainers at the back. No one can find him.
Or caught in the new range that they're trying to do to improve themselves, where they sell fire trap jeans and leather jackets. Come on.
They do sell some random stuff, don't they? It really is.
It's like, if you're gonna buy a pair of jeans and a leather jacket, I'm sorry, but you're not going to go into Sports Direct for it.
No, you ain't. No chance.
No way. So, how did you get into the gardening then? Have you always been interested in gardening?
Well, yeah, my dad was a farmer when I was growing up. When I was born, we lived on a farmhouse. So literally, dad was farming. So we lived in a house rent free, and we used to grow veg in the garden and all that. And you know, I'd see my dad drive past in the tractor in the field, that literally back down onto our garden. So I always wanted to be outside. I hate being indoors. Even now, I can't be indoors for too long. I need to be out. I need to be out breathing in the fresh air and doing a bit. And we used to grow veg in our garden back then. And when I was little, my dad used to send me in amongst all the plants to get all the veg out of the ground that was ready for picking. And I think that's something that always just stuck with me. And then when my dad stopped gardening, he took up when he stopped farming rather, he took up gardening. And uh, that was eventually after a few other jobs, and I started doing a bit of work with him when I finished school, sort of part time and that, so I was still studying, and then I sort of took it on from there, and I enjoyed it. There was some good money to be made from it, and I've always stuck with it. I've always been a practical outdoors type of bloke. I can't. But the idea of being stuck in an office 9 to 5 does my head in, that'd be my nightmare. I've always enjoyed it. I've been doing it now for, blimey, the best part of 20 years I've been gardening. And I've had my own gardening business now for 13 years this year.
That's amazing. That's absolutely amazing, to be honest. And I'm like you, I don't know if it's a southern thing, because obviously, you know, but in the summertime, I love being outside in the garden, have a cold tin, you know, maybe a bit of barbecue on the go. Let the sun into your skin, man. It's good for you.
Yeah, well, it's the same with everything going on at the moment. The vitamin D, it's good for you. It makes you feel better. You know, it's been proven. So, I feel sorry for people that don't have that open space. They don't get them opportunities to go out and take it in, you know. There's a lot of people who work indoors for a living, and they come home to a flat and with no open space near them. Like, that would be a bloody nightmare for me.
So I take it your worst nightmare then would be you doing bird.
Yes.
Because you'd be stuck inside all the time.
Oh, I could do it. This time of year I tend to go a little bit mad because the work's a little bit quieter. You know, obviously gardening is definitely more of a seasonal job. But January and February in particular are the two quietest months of the year. So I'm a bit of a miserable twat January and February. but once March kicks in, I'll cheer up a bit, you know.
It's the same with me, but mine's a different reason. Mine's because of my eyesight, you know, because when you're visually impaired, obviously naturally winter is the worst time of your life. Because it's dark when you get up, and it's dark when you're walking around, it's dark before 4 o'clock in the evening. And then when I think it's around about April, May comes along, my mood just automatically lifts, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what I start enjoying.
I think a lot of people are the same. I think people in general are slightly more down over the winter. It's cold, it's dark, you know. A lot of people get up in the morning in the dark, they come home in the dark, they don't see the sun. And I think everyone gets a bit of a lift when the clocks go forward and the day starts roaring out. I think everyone cheers up a little bit, you know. So,
and let's have it right, it's the time of the year when you pull the most dosh out your wallet.
Oh, it is and all, that doesn't help.
Christmas, New Year, you just want beers, you want loads of food, you just want to sit and get fat, drink everything, eat everything, and then you realise by around about the 7th of January that that everything's half-inched your money.
Yeah, I'm the same every year. I always say every year I ain't going to do it. Christmas comes, all of a sudden everyone turns into Father Christmas, don't they? You've got to get a present for everyone, despite how much money or how little money you've got in the bank account. And then all the bills come out at the beginning of January, and you think, bugger, I've got nothing left.
and then you say, I'm not really going to drink this New Year, I think I'll just take it easy, I'll have one maybe, see the New Year in, and then the next thing you know, you're hugging the toilet bowl. Because you've had one too. I mean, like I said to you on your live, New Year just gone, I had, honest, geez, hell's bells, I went through a full crate of Stella, and it was the bottles as well, not the cans.
God blimey.
I know.
And you, that'll do it. A great Stella, mate. That'll play havoc with your inside.
I think it was 12 bottles.
Yeah.
And I only stopped because I had finished. It was like, oh, there's nothing left. Okay, shall I go and get a bit of this rum? Actually, no. Stop it, Richie. Go to bed. Yeah. Get to bed now.
We've all been there. It's I think that's the good thing about drinking different beers. You don't get them after effects. You don't feel as bad the next day. You know, if I get me wrong, you still get battered, but you don't feel as bad for it the next day.
So if you get paggered on, like, a decent IPA, the hangover wouldn't be as bad as if you got paggered on, like, say, for example, Foster's?
Definitely.
Wow. So definitely. It is true.
I've been out, like, you know, to be local pub, and had, like, you know, 5 or 6 pints of Stella, and not felt particularly battered. But the next morning, you feel awful. You've got a banging headache, you're inside, you just want to go to the toilet. But then I've done sessions where I've been to a tap room from a decent brewery, and drunk about 9 or 10 pints of a good quality pale ale. Been got home, feeling nice and drunk, woke up the next morning like nothing happened.
So do you think? Do you think?
You get what you pay for. If you drink good quality beer, granted you'll probably pay a little bit more for it, but it's better for you.
So do you think it's the mass-produced lager thing is just a phase you go through when you're young because you're uneducated with the beers? Because I've noticed, like, I used to sit there as a teenager in the working man's clubs and point and laugh at all the old men. Ah, look at them. What the hell are they drinking? And I'm sat there with a bloody bottle of Brunel or a pint of Carlin, and they're laughing at me going, ah, look at what they're drinking. So it must be age. As you adapt in time, you become more mature to the alcohol.
That's definitely. You can't tell people for a young age what to drink or what not to drink. I think you have to make your own mistakes. That's how you learn. And I think when you drink down a pub and drink your lager, you drink it because it's there, right? It's accessible. It's the first thing you see.
Yeah, it's
colourful. It's bright. It's probably the cheapest beer there is, and you don't mind it because it doesn't really taste that much. But then at least I can only speak for me, but when I started discovering different styles of beers, IPAs and things like that, I suddenly thought, you know, blimey, is this how beer is supposed to taste, you know? And then it kind of goes from there. But I spent pretty much the first 10 years of my drinking life just drinking mass-produced lager and you know, thought that was as good as it got, you know? So it's never too late to try.
I think I'm slowly getting to that transition, Paul, where I'm starting to want to, where I'm wanting to evolve into the actual proper beer world, because it was just before the lockdown. I went to the Wetherspoons with my mum, and she says, "Oh, do you want a pint of Stella Rich?" And I went, "Nah." She went, "What?" I says, "Nah." She went, "Well, what do you want then?" I says, "I want a Guinness." And I sat there and I drank that Guinness, and Paul, honestly, it felt euphoric. It was Guinness on tap, and I would never in a minute. If you told me 20 years ago I would have enjoyed Guinness, I would have told you to pee off. Yeah. You know?
Guinness is a classic. Guinness is a classic. I wouldn't say it's any longer the best stout out there, but it is a classic. It is what it is. They don't cut any corners. The recipe is still good. It's still a decent stout. It'll get your bladder if you drink too much of it, but I promise you, you won't feel half as bad for it the next day as you would if you drunk, you know, half a dozen pints of Stella.
I must be getting to that stage in life though, Paul, because once upon a time I'd just pick up a creative bud and be like, I'm happy with that. Now when I go into the local corner shop or a supermarket, I'm standing there with my hands on my chin questioning,
yeah.
So I must be hitting that spot where I want to, you know, so...
Your taste buds change, don't they?
Yes.
As you get older, you know.
I now hate mass-produced lagers. Like, not all of them. I can't sit here and lie because I do like Amstel and San Miguel, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But it's went from me... This is how bad it is. You're even going to cringe, yeah? It's went from me enjoying Coors Light and Foster's to now where I won't even look at them. To now I only enjoy San Miguel, Amstel or Budweiser, and now I'm even starting to like look at Budweiser with some hacky looks.
Yeah,
so,
it was the same for me. I used to love Coors Light. I used to drink that by the crate. I used to like, because they chopped the ABV. When I was drinking Coors Light, it used to be 5% when it first came out over here, and it was a completely different tasting beer. But because it had that light, sort of really thin mouthfeel, it was almost smooth when you drunk it. You could drink a crate and get pissed. You didn't realise it was happening.
Mm-hmm.
But then they chopped the ABV down to 4%, and it just tasted completely different. The recipe was absolutely destroyed, to the point now where, it's one of the worst mass-produced lagers out there.
I agree.
I think you'd be off your head to buy it. You know, from my standpoint, there's so much better out there. But like I say, I used to drink it like it was going out of fashion. You know, I couldn't get enough of it, but it tastes changed.
I agree. I was never a massive fan of Coors Light, but I did used to drink it. I was more, when I was younger, where we come from, you always hammered either White Storm cider, which is just chemical crap put into a 3-litre bottle and sold for like $2.50. It was either that or you drank Stella Artois by the bottle, And if you were really, really Raj, it would be LCL Orchestral Super Strength.
Oh, blimey.
LCL, come on, LCL.
Crikey, that stuff will kill you.
That blows your brains out, that stuff. I've seen people, honest to God, Paul, I've seen people walking around the streets of Asherton at 7 o'clock in the morning with a kind of 10-inch super strength.
Yeah, I think you see that most places you go, don't you? Most towns, you get the geezer walking around first thing in the morning with a big old can of super strength on him. You know,
it's like 10% ABV, isn't it not?
Some of them, I think Kestrel's about 8 or 9.
Wow.
It's just overly sweet. It's just full of glucose. It's just not nice.
It's probably full of hop extract. It's probably not even real hop.
Yeah, the quality of the ingredients that go into it won't be great. There's flavourings and things added to kind of make it drinkable. But it will get you absolutely wanked. There's no two ways about it. So if you want a few of them just to get drunk, then that's the go-to. But it's, if you just want to have a few beers and actually enjoy them, then you don't go for that.
I'd feel sorry for anybody's head the next day if you had four of them.
Well, I feel sorry for anyone who's in the state where they think that's the beer to go for. You know, most of these people that we're talking about usually hit hard times, so you kind of feel sorry for them in that sense. But I don't know anyone who's kind of doing all right in life, who's recovering, who would choose to drink that. You know, I've reviewed them. I've reviewed them on the channel.
Yeah, I've seen you do one, and your face was a picture.
Yeah,
you were like, nah, no.
Yeah, it's just not good. It's just too sweet. You know, it's still probably better than Coors Light and Carling, but it's just too sweet. There's too much artificial flavouring gone into it. You know.
So for the guy like me that's come to a certain age and they're sat there and they're thinking, I think I may put down the mass-produced lager and see what tickles me fancy. What would be your advice for the first-time trier for a proper beer?
Well, it depends what you classify as a proper beer. I mean, there are lagers out there that are really good. You know, if we've all grown, like I say, I drank Foster's most of the time when I was younger. That was kind of the go-to lager out there. That was available in all the pubs. So I kind of made the progression, sort of going from the mass-produced cheap stuff. I started drinking sort of more of like the imported stuff, like your San Miguel's and your Heineken's and like Amstel's and things like that.
And that's what they would class as the specialised.
Well, yeah, they called them premium lagers, didn't they? They all had the word
premium
on somewhere. You know, even Stella. But I'd still don't mind the Stella now. I don't like it from a bottle, but I'll still drink a can of Stella every now and then. Yeah, I don't think that's terrible. But if you're a lager drinker and you want something with a bit more flavour. I could say it depends what your local shop is, but there's some really good German lagers available. The San Miguel, which is pretty readily available. I know Tesco, they sell the imported version, the Spanish version, and that stuff is blinding. That's a really good quality lager. It's got a really good mouthfeel to it. It's made with really good ingredients. It's not filtered, you know, to within an inch of its life. You've got Warsteiner, which is a really good German lager. You've got Kronbacher, which is another really good German lager. You've got Camden Hells. You know, there's plenty out there. I tell you what, the best advice, a lot of the supermarkets, the mass-produced lagers, if you go down the beer aisle, the mass-produced stuff tends to be on one side of the aisle.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the boxes and that.
Yeah.
If you just turn round, just spin your ass round and have a look at the beers on the other side of the aisle, that's where you tend to get the better quality stuff.
See, that's the problem with that's the problem with my local Asda. If you spin your ass around, it's all the rums and the whiskies and the vodkas and the peach schnapps.
Ah, see. Yeah.
So they're trying to deter you away from it, I think.
I think so. Asda are pretty poor. Their beer section has really been it's been left behind by all the other supermarkets, unfortunately. But you can still get some good ones in Asda. Like I say, they'll sell. You can get Brooklyn Lager in there.
Ooh, yes.
That's worth a go. So I'm pretty sure they sell San Miguel. You can get Holsten Pils. I still think Holsten Pils is a decent lager.
I actually tried Holsten Pils once because of one of your videos, and I've got to admit, I did enjoy it.
Yeah, it's one of them. It's almost like a forgotten lager, Holston Pils. I've always had a bit of a soft spot for it because obviously you'll probably know they used to be the main sponsor of Tottenham Hotspur back in the day. So
they did, yes.
Growing up, I used to see Holston plaster all over my shirt. You know, so it was I never knew nothing of it. But it's almost become the forgotten beer because it's there. They kind of put it top shelf, yellow can with a green trim, and they haven't changed the styling, they haven't changed the font for years and years, and it's almost become that forgotten beer. But I think it's precisely because of that they keep the effort of the beer to a decent level.
It's a true fact, because I remember I went into my local offie and I says, this was actually the same weekend when I saw your video, because you kept saying Holston Pils, it's this, it's that, the other, and I thought, ooh, I'm going to give that a try. I walked into my local offie, I says, excuse me, you got a... any Holston Pils? Do you know what the reply was?
Go on in.
What's that?
You're joking.
I'm deadly serious, mate. What's that? I says, it's in a green and yellow can. Yellow can, green trim, says Holston Pils. And he went, is this it? I went, yes.
Yeah, it doesn't help really when you've got people selling beer and they don't know what they're actually selling.
I know, I couldn't believe it.
That's a bit of an issue as well. It's I think beer kind of struggles with its own reputation. It's almost part of the lad culture, isn't it, having a few beers and things like that. But that's slowly changing with the development of beers and things, I think, for the better. But when you've got people flogging it that can give a toss, that's not very good for beer. But there's plenty out there. Like I say, just sort of turn away from the mass-produced stuff, the crates, you know, because most of the time, the really good beers, you won't be able to buy in massive boxes like that. You know,
they come in singular or individual.
Yeah, that's it. You'll get individuals. You might get a pack of four or something like that. You know, but explore. You know, if you're a lager drinker, believe me, there's some really good lagers out there. You don't have to go for the same ones all the time.
It's not the case that we're being pompous. It's just like. We admit it, the world has been absolutely obliterated by Budweiser, Carlsberg, Foster's, you know, Heineken, Stella.
Yep.
That's all you ever see. And
yep.
It's these
quality. One thing I will say for them breweries is that they knock out their product consistently. That's sometimes that's the what could be thrown at the newer craft brewers, is that often you'll get like a really good batch of a beer and you love it, and then they release another batch, and you get hold of it, and it doesn't quite taste the same.
Yeah, so they must have tampered with it or done something different.
Well, that's it. The brewing process is so much more sensitive because the quality of ingredients they're using is so much better. But then give credit to people like Stella Artois. Once you've had a Stella, you know what a Stella tastes like. You can't go wrong with it. If you like it, you like it. Which is why I'll never criticise what people drink. If someone turns around to me and says, I love Foster's, I'm like, okay, cool.
That's my wife. All my wife drinks is Foster's. Honestly, you can't get away from her on a Friday.
Well, so there's nothing wrong with it, but all I say is, well, if you like Foster's, maybe you'll like this instead and offer them an alternative, and I promise it'll be better for you, and it'll be better quality ingredients going into your body. And I think that's the big thing that the people don't, people on the outside don't understand. They just assume if you don't drink Foster's then you're a beer snob. honestly, it's not the case. It's like, if there's nothing else left and I want a beer, I'll have a Foster's.
You've got the other side of the spectrum though, because like one time I switched my choice up, I got four cans of Heineken, the pint ones, like the big one you had on your video on the Champions League day.
That's right.
And my dad turned around and went, what are you drinking that sheep's piss for? So it can be on the other side of the spectrum as well. People can look down on the mass-produced, you know?
Yeah, a lot of people do. So I choose not to. Like I say, if I don't like a beer, I won't drink it.
The way I see it, Paul, is beer's beer, and if you enjoy beer, and we can all have a beer, no matter what the beer is, then hooray.
Exactly. No one's in a position to tell someone else that what they're drinking is shit. You know, if they like it, then good luck to them.
And let's admit it as well, how amazing would it be to have a pint of Stella at the actual Stella Brewery?
Oh, it would be.
That would be, oh, wow.
It would be. That's on my bucket list. To go to Leuven in Belgium and actually get a pint of Stella from their brewery. That would be incredible.
I've seen a reviewer.
My list is pretty big.
That's on my list as well. One of them was New Yorker did that, but I've seen a reviewer, do that. Have a pint of Stella outside the place, and he said he's drank Stella his whole life, and it was the best Stella he ever had.
Yeah, I mean, I had a pint of Dutch Heineken for the first time last year, and it blew my mind. Because I've been drinking Heineken, you know, on a regular. I've always quite enjoyed Heineken. But when you drink the actual proper imported Dutch stuff, it's a completely different animal. It's incredible. And that's how it's supposed to taste, you know. But it's the same with anything. If you go to the source, the beer you're going to get is of a better quality.
The three drink locations that's on my bucket list, I've ticked one out of three, is Stella at the Stella Brewery, Guinness at Belfast, and Long Island Iced Tea in New York, and I did the Long Island Iced Tea in New York.
Oh, nice.
And that, my friend, was a different league.
I've got a few. I like Sierra Nevada Pale Ale. That's quite readily available in a lot of the supermarkets. That is a stunning California-based beer.
Yeah, that's the West Coast IPA, isn't it?
Yeah, they have the different ones. They've got the Sierra Nevada Pale Ale, which is like the classic, the brown bottle with a green label on it. But they do an IPA as well. They do a Sierra Nevada California IPA, which is in the blue can. Both stunning beers. But on my bucket list is to go to the Sierra Nevada Brewery in California.
Which I would assume is in Las Vegas.
It's not actually. You think it would be in it with the Sierra Nevada bit. But no, it's in the state of California. But that's on my. I want to go there and drink a fresh pint of Sierra Nevada Pale Ale. I'll be in heaven.
How amazing would that be, man? That would be the crispest of the crisp.
Yeah, but it's like when you eat a good steak. You know, like every mouthful, you're like, oh god, that's good.
Yeah.
That's how beer should be. When you find a really good beer, you like that with every mouthful. And I think when you drink the beer from the source, that's as close as you get.
Yeah, I agree. So I've got a question here for you as well about beer. I know we're talking a lot about alcohol tonight, guys, because this is Paul from Paul's Beers on YouTube. He's very good at what he does. He's very entertaining. I love his lives. If you've never heard of him, I don't know where the hell you've been. But if you could go onto YouTube and just in the search box, just type in Paul's Beers, and he's a baldy fella with a big Viking beard. And just click the subscribe and hit the bell. Because he's a great man and he knows what he's talking about. So that's why we're talking about beer a lot. We're not alcoholics, we just appreciate beer.
Yeah, but we ain't got problems, we're alright.
So I haven't got a drinking problem. What was it that, I've seen that somewhere, it's a funny joke. He goes, hey, oh man, do you know the Jeff Dunham?
Yeah.
The comedian, he goes, hey Billy, have you got a drink problem? He goes, no, I've got it under control. And then he goes, what's your favourite beer? An open one. So I thought that was quite funny. But the question I've got here is, would you ever brew your own beer?
I'd love to brew my own beer.
And what would it be?
Oh, blimey. If I could brew any beer right now, I'd love to have a go at a good West Coast style IPA.
Lovely.
A good West Coast style IPA. That's quite a specific style. You get your IPAs. I mentioned Life and Death earlier by Vocation, which is a really good IPA. That beer kind of covers all of the bases with IPA. A good West Coast IPA should be nice and hoppy. There should be a nice bit of bitterness at the back end. There should be like a bit of a piney flavour to it. There'd be a bit of a tropical fruit flavour on it as well. It just takes your taste buds on a bit of a journey.
So are you for or against the orange peel?
It depends on the style. I mean, again, we spoke earlier about Blue Moon.
Yeah.
And that's full of it. And that's one of my favourite beers.
I'm going to try that. I'm definitely going to try it.
Yeah, it depends on the style. You know, I mean, like Fuller's beers down in London, down here, Fuller's beers in Chiswick. Their malts, their sort of classic malt that they put in their beers, like London Pride and ESB and Bengal Lancer and that. The malt that they use has a very kind of very subtle, but it's there, like an orange flavour to it.
Yeah.
And it's their classic sort of signature malt that they use in their beers. But in terms of the orange peel, if you're brewing like a wheat beer, like a Blue Moon is, which is like a creamy, it's brewed with oats, so it's very smooth, very creamy on the mouthfeel.
Nice.
If you add orange peel to that, it's really pronounced. You get a really refreshing yet smooth beer. So it can work an absolute treat.
So the Blue Moon original on mango is definitely a good one to pick up for me and the old man in the summer then.
It's definitely a summer smasher.
I'll be getting it done. I'll buy one when we can have BBQs again.
Good man.
Right, so what was I going to say? Oh, yes. So I've been doing my research into the proper beers, especially for tonight, and I'm assuming, correct me if I'm wrong, IPA is India Pale Ale.
That's right.
Brilliant. Hey, the Indians do great stuff. Tea, you know, pale ale. There's a great tea.
Originally, they were brewed over here.
Yep.
And what it was, they were basically a pale ale, but they kind of put extra hops in them, because if you put like extra hops in the beers and things like that, it helps them keep longer. So what was happening? This beer was kind of being exported over to our troops and our boys over in India during the wartime.
Yeah.
Because it was taking time to ship it, they realised that if you packed it out with extra hops and things like that, the beer stayed good longer. So by the time it got to our boys over in India, it was still tasting.
Brilliant.
Basically, that style caught on. People realised they wanted a stronger, more of a bitter, hoppy type of beer. And it caught on from there. And now it's the style itself has just expanded into so many kind of sub-genres. It's the king, really.
Well, I can promise you tonight on this podcast, I will be trying an IPA by the end of this year, and I'm going to be letting you know about it.
Definitely. Let me know how you get on with it.
So what actually got you into the beer reviews? Like, why did you just open a can one day and say, I'm going to record this and upload it to YouTube, or was it an orchestrated plan?
It kept popping into my head. I was kind of say at the beginning of my beer journey, like we discussed earlier, where I've been drinking lager for years, and I'd suddenly sort of started getting into more styles. I discovered like Punk IPA from Brewdog, and that was the first proper IPA I ever drunk, and I was just like, shit, you know, is this what beer can taste like? You know, it blew my mind a little bit. And then as soon as I had that beer, that was it. I wanted to try all these different, you know, it's like we're saying about the beer aisle at the supermarket.
Yeah.
Suddenly I was drawn to the other side, and I started seeing all these different beer styles and beer names from different countries, and I thought, I want to get involved. And next thing I knew, I was trying everything I saw. You know, I was slowly losing interest in the mass-produced lagers.
Yeah.
And then what I started doing, I was going on YouTube. If I saw a beer on the shelf, I wasn't necessarily buying it. What I was doing, I was going home and doing my research and finding out about it. And then I discovered that there were blokes on YouTube that reviewed beer. And I thought, wow, you know. So I started watching it, and you see this bloke open up a beer, you know, let us know what aroma he got, what he got on the smell, and what he thought it tasted like, and what it looked like in the glass and all that. And I thought, that's really good. But what a lot of them weren't doing, which pissed me off a little bit, was they weren't telling us where they got it. And
right.
They weren't telling us how much they paid for it.
So it was kind of like they were keeping it a secret from you.
Yeah, it was almost like they were, you know, kind of like rubbing it in your nose, but not letting you know where you could get it. And it really pissed me off. So I was like, you know what? I thought about it. I thought, I could do this. I could go out, buy a beer, crack it open, talk to my phone, and let people know if it's any good, where you can get it, and how much you've got to pay for it,
yeah,
in general. I thought it'd be a good service. And I thought about it for a little while, and I thought, do I really want to put myself out there? Because, I mean, as you know, once you kind of go out onto the, sort of any media platform, you're leaving yourself open to ridicule.
Oh, without a doubt. But you know what I say, mate? I say, you ain't nobody until you got some haters.
I think that's the truth. That's the truth. But I've only really noticed over the last sort of year or so, since the channel's really sort of blown up, that you do get the odd shitty comment.
I used to fly off me handle back in the day when I'd get them, and people coming on, I'd be like, shut the fuck up, you little Raj Packard, I'll punch your face in, like that kind of thing. Now, like, I'll get the most vilest, well, I haven't had any for a while, touch wood, because I'm starting to get more love now, but now if I get, like, a comment, like a really vile, disgusting comment, I'll just say, thank you very much for your time, God bless, was it worth a thumb, you know?
Yeah.
Stuff like that, and they can't react to it, because how can you be nasty to someone that's being nice to you?
Yeah, that's it.
Like, if you come on my video and you go, oh, Blind Man B, I'm a rock fan, I think rap's crap, you know, give up, like, obviously you wouldn't, but if you did, I would just say, thank you very much for the extra view, mate, if that's your opinion, then there's other musicians out there that you may enjoy, you know,
yeah,
something like
that's it, but that was basically how I got started. I was enjoying the beer reviews, but I just wanted to know where they were getting it, and I figured if one person wants that information, I thought other people would want that information. So I started the channel, started reviewing beers, I was telling people where I got it, how much I paid for it, and I genuinely try and review beers that everyone can get.
Yes.
Yeah, I try and review beers that you'll get in the supermarkets, or even your Lidl's, your Aldi's, places like that. I'm not out to go and buy the most expensive beer in the world, because there's a lot of people who can't afford them, and
exactly,
half the time they ain't worth the money.
That's what I actually, it's funny you mention it, because the irony is that's actually one of the main points in your videos that I adore, when you would sit there and you'd say, like, oh, I picked this up from my local offie for 99 pence, you know, and I'm thinking, good on them, because a lot of people would be like, oh, this is amazing, and I'm keeping this to myself because I don't want other people to enjoy this, like me, kind of thing, you know?
Yeah, so I don't know if they were doing it deliberately, but there just seems to be like a running pattern there. They talk about how good the beer was, and they're like, okay, that's great, where can I get it? And they just wouldn't tell you.
Yeah, you're like, where the bloody hell do I get it then? And they don't...
Yeah. So I started doing it for myself, and I thought I'll let people know where I've got the beer and whether it's any good or not, you know, and let people make their own decisions.
So have you tried the one on my shirt tonight, McEwan's?
I've had a couple of McEwan's beers over the years. I've had their Headspace, I've had their Champion.
Any good?
The Headspace is the one with was meant to have a, I think it was meant to be aged in a whiskey barrel for a little while. That was quite an interesting ale. But they've been around for donkey's years, haven't they, McEwan?
I've never ever put my lips around a can or a bottle of McEwan's.
Oh, you've got to do it. If you wear the Newcastle shirt, if it plastered on the front of it, you've got to do it, haven't you?
That's what my cousin said as well. He's like, what? He's younger than me as well. He's only in his early 20s. He's like, you've never drank a can of McEwan's. I went, nah. Because back in my day, Paul, it was all about the brown ale, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
We were all about the brown ale, you know, you get the bottle of it, and it, and even that's changed as well.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah. I mean, back in the day, it was meant to be fantastic.
It was.
It's still one of my dad's favourite beers. So, as I say, my dad's mum was from Newcastle as well, so I've got a bit of Newcastle in me. So
that's got to be confusing. That's got to be confusing. Half London or half Geordie.
Well, not quite that bad, but yeah, he was a London boy, but I didn't notice until sort of later on in life that my name was a Geordie. It was funny, but yeah, my dad used to love Newcastle Brown when I was growing up. He'd either be drinking lager or Newcastle Brown, and even now he still have a Newcastle Brown. I keep telling him, it's not what it was, and he's like, yeah, I agree, but he still likes it. He still likes the flavour.
I'm not gonna lie. Every now and again, weirdly enough, it usually falls around about my birthday. I like to have one bottle of it. Just, I don't know. Maybe it's just the northeast thing. But so what part of Newcastle did your grandma come from?
I honestly, I've got no idea. I need to get back to you on that. I've never really gone into it too much. But all I know is, I didn't know very. All my grandparents were passed away by the time I was about 10.
Yeah.
I didn't really get the chance to get to know her. But my dad always tells us she was a Geordie, and obviously his dad was a Londoner, and she obviously came down south to work, and that's how they met. But I'll have to find out for you. Hopefully you'll know the area.
So you've got to have tried mince and dumplings then, surely.
Oh, well, I've had stew and dumplings, but I had mince and dumplings.
Oh, you've got to have mince and dumplings. You've got to. It's the best meal in the world. I've actually got some review requests for you here, personally from me, and I would love it if you could give me a shout-out on the reviews.
Yeah.
So, you can agree or disagree. You can tell me to naff off, but my requests are Perlenbacher.
Right, yep.
Obviously, Newcastle Brown Ale, because I'm from the Northeast. I know you've probably drank it, but I would like a review of it. And peas pudding.
Peas pudding?
Yep, peas pudding.
What bloody is that?
Peas pudding is like something that you put in a ham sandwich.
Right.
If I can, I'll send you some. You've got to try it.
I'm going to have to look that up.
You've got to try it. Mate, it's the best thing ever in a sandwich, honestly.
Yeah?
Now, if you're... Your Geordie family would have been sitting there screaming, "Yes, Paul, do it! Peas pudding is amazing."
Oh, good, that's doing it.
You've got to have ham and peas pudding in a stotty.
Right.
With a Newcastle Brown Ale.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, I've got a Newcastle Brown Ale review coming up. I bought a sub. I've got like a sub beer machine.
Yeah, I've seen that. It's massive.
Yeah. And I bought a Newcastle Brown one for it because I fancied having it on draft because I've never actually had a pint of Newcastle Brown from a pub because you just don't get it around here. You know, you get it in the supermarkets, but you don't get it in the pubs for obvious reasons.
You don't get it in a pint up here neither. You always get it given to you in the bottle.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, every time, there's probably Geordie men in their 50s and 60s screaming at me now going, "Liar, liar." But every time I went to the pub, you always got it in the bottle.
See, that's right. I always imagined if I went out drinking in Newcastle, you'd find at least one pub that was selling Newcastle Brown on draft.
Yeah, without a doubt. It has to be.
No, you don't want the bottles, really. Not if you're going into a pub in Newcastle.
No, you want it in the glass.
You want a proper pint, you know.
I mean, I'm going from my experience, so I'm not saying it's not a fact, but I'm assuming there is pubs in the Northeast where you can get it in the glass, but I would love to be able to try that because I've only ever had it out of the bottle or the can.
Yeah, I'm the same.
Now, are you for or against drinking out of the can? Because I've noticed you always pour it in the glass. Now, I know that's because of your reviews for the colour, but off camera, would you pop the can and neck it there and then, or do you have to pour it in the glass?
It depends on the style of beer. I literally had a couple of cans of Stella the other night with a curry. I've just done them out of a can. I've got no problem with drinking a beer out of a can.
Just a lot of people tend to say, "Oh, you can't do that. You get the tin taste, you know." And you just go and then neck it.
Yeah. Now, if you're getting tin taste in the beer, that's not because of the fact it's been in the tin. It's because it's shit beer. Basically. If you're getting tinny in, flavouring in your beer is because it's been made badly, you know, or it's been sat in a can for too bloody long. That's another thing to look out for when you're buying beer. Look at the use by date on them.
Yeah.
Because it's at the end of the day, beer is a fresh product. You know, you're not going to go into a shop and buy black bananas, are you?
No, or you wouldn't toy something in the bin and then pull it back out.
That's it. It's the same with beer. At the end of the day, beer is used fresh ingredients. You're using, you know, water, barley, malts, wheat, things like that. Hops, you know, hops are a flower at the end of the day. You know, they've got to be fresh to give you the proper flavour. If supermarkets are selling beer that's only got like 2 months shelf life left on it, when it initially had a year, then they shouldn't be selling it full price. But there's so many people that don't do it. But your question is why? Why don't you do it? Pick up a can, pick up a bottle, look at the bottom, find out what the dating is. Get the freshest possible beer you can get. I guarantee you'll get a better date.
I've got to admit, I'm guilty for not doing that, but I've got an excuse. I'm half blind, so I'm Stevie Wonder. So now when I go to buy the lager, I might ask the shopkeeper to read the date.
Yeah, just to say, if you can, if you get the time, just have a look at the date. Because say it's worth doing because a lot of supermarkets are bad for it. You know, obviously they put the older stock at the front, don't they? They've got to get rid of it.
And that's the reason for the bargain bins then.
Yeah, exactly that.
Because it's shite and it's borderline out of date.
Yep. And wow. It's obviously the fresh ingredient initially, so you should be drinking beer as fresh as you can get it.
That's absolutely crazy. So I've got a just to finish off, I've got some flash questions for you. You just say the first answer that comes to your head.
Okay.
So, AC/DC or Black Sabbath?
Oh, bloody hell. I'm going to say AC/DC.
You good man. I love them both, but AC/DC tip it just for me as well.
Yeah.
No better than a bit of Hell's Bells.
AC/DC, you love them. If you like one AC/DC song, you like them all, don't you?
Oh, I love AC/DC. Okay, so I've got here Nirvana or Metallica?
Metallica.
Oh, that was nice and quick.
No doubt.
Queen or... what's that say? Queen... Oh, I don't know what that says. I was just going to say something like Queen or like heavy metal, so like your commercial rock or your heavy rock.
Oh, I absolutely adore Queen.
Queen are amazing.
Absolutely love them. They inspired so many bands, and they don't even realise it. It's yeah. I grew up listening to a lot of Queen. Freddie was an absolute genius.
Greatest singer ever of all time, and you'll never get another one.
He's right up there. He was a hell of an entertainer.
I've got here. Axl Rose or Lemmy?
Lemmy.
Easy, I agree. I love Motorhead. Yep. Xbox or PlayStation?
Oh, blimey. I've probably had more experience with Xbox.
Okay, wow. That's cool. Yeah. FIFA or Pro Soccer Evolution?
FIFA.
Yes, easy. We've got here The Godfather or Scarface?
Godfather.
Wow, I agree. Scarface was a little bit weird, but it was good at the same time.
Oh yeah.
Pilsner or IPA?
IPA.
Stout or bitter?
Stout.
And then I've got San Miguel or Amstel, which I already know the answer to because you told us yesterday. But
I would say San Miguel.
Although you wouldn't push an Amstel out of the way if it got given to you.
No chance. I still enjoy an Amstel, yeah.
this is a little bit of a naughty one. I just thought I'd put it on you. Arsenal or Chelsea?
Oh, fuck. I hate both of them. Can't.
I had a feeling that was going to be the reaction.
Arsenal, I hate with a passion. Chelsea, I just don't like. So, Arsenal are my enemies, obviously. So,
and Newcastle United or Sunderland? Be careful.
Newcastle United.
Oh, thank God for that. I was going to say, I don't want them to get trolls, but on my channel. Paul, you're an absolute legend, mate. This is a beautiful friendship that's going to develop, and I give you nothing but respect and salute, dude.
Oh, thank you very much, mate. Thank you very much.
Just please, pleasure. Please keep doing what you're doing. Please keep up with the channel because you're absolutely class. I enjoy your videos, and I hope from here we don't be strangers.
No, definitely not. We'll stay in touch and we'll keep doing some things together. That'd be great.
And just for the benefit of this video, when you do watch it back, I'm pointing a cup at the screen, which is part of my merchandise for Coast Radio 106.6 FM. I'm going to send you one of them. And I'm going to send you a good old bottle of air or can of McEwen's lager.
That'd be lovely.
And don't forget your reviews that I asked you to do because you said you got a bad memory.
That's it. So we got Perlenbacher from Lidl, we got Nuki Brown, and what was the other one? The peas in the pod, what was it called?
It's called Peas Pudding.
Peas Pudding, there we go. Yep. Peas Pudding. I'm going to look that up now and I'm going to get some.
God bless you, fella. I thank you very much for your time because I know you're a busy man and I want to give me absolute respect to your missus as well because what she does is absolutely amazing and we love and appreciate every single thing that she does.
No, thank you very much, mate. I really appreciate it.
No worries. God bless, dude.
Cheers, mate.
Bye-bye. There you go, guys. Paul from Paul's Beers. What a man. He's an absolute legend, man. Go and check him out on YouTube and subscribe to his channel and hit the bell. And if you can as well, please subscribe to my channel, A Blind Man's Podcast. Hit the bell for notifications for the next videos. And Paul, congratulations, my friend. You have just been put onto the same list as one of your favourite artists, bands, Dire Straits. It's down there. God bless, guys. Thank you to Kar-Ching. Peace.